original Deer in the Headlights?
Yeah, Dave decided he wanted to do Deer in Headlights, and bravo for the performance. Thanks for being here. Welcome to BrigadeCon 2016 in my game room here. I have retired Major David A. Wesely with us, who is credited for inventing the role-playing game. And since this is the online role-playing convention, I guess this is kind of your fault that we're here right now.
Yes, it is. I can't wait until the about Dungeons and Dragons find out.
Yes, exactly. Bad. What we're going to be doing here is we're going to be just chatting. We'll have some time in the comments if you want to add any questions as you're watching this. And we're going to have a good time. I convinced Dave to come down in what we have named the Pete M. Gaylord Memorial Game Room.
Yes.
And his picture's looking over us, and we're going to take some time to just talk about gaming from almost half a century back now. I wasn't there for a lot of this.
Yeah.
But first, I know you're a huge fan of cheap beer. But above that, you call yourself a Minnesotan.
I'm a Minnesotan.
So we will be drinking Grain Belt Northeast, which the funny thing is no one in Northeast Minneapolis calls it Northeast, from what I've noticed. But
yeah, it tends to be a, well, it's a double thing. On one hand, because it was 75 years ago, it was heavily settled by Scandinavian immigrants, for whom East would seem to be about right. You know, the way that they had their accents at the time. But mostly it's called Northeast in derision of those people on the part of the totally accentless Irish who were running the city at the time, you know. And so there is a whole layer after layer of ridiculing the new immigrants that goes on in every American city, right? Jacob Riis and How the Other Half Lives, back before the 20th, beginning of the 20th century, did a nice study of where all the different ethnic groups moved into the city and how, like successive layers of sediment and rocks, the map of New York City had shifted and shifted and shifted as different groups moved in, became to dominate a certain part of town, and that eventually got reasonably well-to-do and assimilated and moved out. And another group of immigrants came in and moved into even more run-down old houses and so on. And so Northeast Minneapolis in 1900 was probably a bunch of pretty nice new up-and-coming, bustling community out along the streetcar lines, and then decayed and became the subject of ridicule because all those foreigners lived up there, just like my ancestors lived in the despicable neighborhood of Swede Hollow in St. Paul. Though honest, to be quite honest, none of my ancestors lived there, but my Swedish Americans lived there. And they actually, that when passed on to other ethnic groups that came in later as the Swedes got rich and moved to the suburbs, still can be called Swede Hollow until 1950s when the city of St. Paul went up and burned it all down. Talking about really despicable.
That's one way to take care of it. So yes, in the fine Minnesota tradition, which I'm kind of more ashamed of now, but here's a Minnesota beer. We'll toast, and we're drinking out of Braunsteins, which we'll get to. We'll get to, but there's a reason we're drinking out of these brown mugs with the wooden handles. So cheers, and we'll raise a stein for Braunstein. Yep, there we go. Now, I have a couple artifacts that as we've gotten to know each other, and here's the kind of friend that Dave is. The last time I was at a game night is at his house, I walked into the room, and he just very, like only a true friend would do, he looked at me and said, and only my real friends would bother to tell me something like that. So I appreciate that. But as we've had lots of conversations.
Nathan here is very tall.
Yes.
And I was sitting down at the time. And so I had a remarkably close view. and was therefore able, with my incredible perception, to notice the fact that his fly was on set.
Yeah, so we've chatted a lot, not just about flies, but also about gaming, the history. We're both Minnesotans, so a lot of conversations there. But you told me a story once about.
Once?
Well, you've told me lots of stories, lots of times, but I remember distinctly a story. Now, this is not the book, but this is a library book. It is on the inside. And some of you, chime in the comments if you can remember this. There were stamps of when a book was checked out. There's a little card you could put in there. You put your name. And this is pre-computer, how you would know who checked out the book. And let's check back in. It goes back in the pocket.
Well, our Wargames group, which was very small in the 1964 time frame, in 65 this happened, we had maybe five of us who were playing war games, and four older guys who were not really into war games, were interested in military miniatures. We were always on the lookout for more bodies in those days, in early 1960s and late 50s. I got into war gaming in 1958 when Avalon Hills Gettysburg game came out. I found it in a bookstore. I was going to buy a Tarzan book, and instead I bought a game. So getting back on the subject, we were all looking on the lookout for more people. And then one day, we were contacted by a guy who just moved in, Dan Nicholson, who just moved in from Bozeman, Montana, where he had been in college, and he was now at graduate school at U. And he had gone to the university library and looked up whether they had any books on war games. Now, there were precious few books on that subject around in those days. And he was amazed to find that they had a book that had been printed back in 1880 that was about war games. It was a 340-page set of war games rules for use for training the U.S. Army. And it had been a library presumably since 1880-something, when it had been acquired for the ROTC detachment at the U and then pushed into the library.
And do you think you found this in the card catalog?
Oh, yes.
under looking up Wargaming in the W's, or?
Yeah, I looked up Wargaming in the W and was amazed to find there was actually a title. If I'd gone to the Ham University Library, I wouldn't have found anything about war games. Actually, it's not quite true in a way. I would have found something. There was something called the War Game, which had nothing to do with Wargaming. It was the title of a very gross anti-war movie about how everyone was going to die in the next war because we're all going to get nuked. But that's a different subject. And in those days, when you wanted to check a book out, you hook up to the front desk and you took the card out of the envelope in the little pouch in the back and you signed it with your student ID alongside it and all that, handed it to the librarian, who verified that you really were a student. It was okay for you to check the book out. And then they stuck that into a card file, and that would be set up by the date it was due. And every day they'd go through that card file, find all the books that were due, contact all the students who hadn't brought them back yet, and so on. When they came back with the book, they'd take the card back out, they'd put it back in the back of the book, and the book would go back on the shelf. It meant, however, that the names of every person who checked that book out from the beginning of the card were on that card. And Dan looked at it and realized there's a chance to find some more Wargamers. So he just took all the people who checked it out in the last 5 years.
Not since 1880?
Well, he could reasonably assume that the ones who checked it out in 1884 were no longer with us.
Yeah.
It's funny, though, it never occurred to me until just now that if we'd really been thinking, we would have checked up every name on the card. We might have found that there was some eager wargamer who was 72 years old who'd never found an opponent for any of the games he'd read about in that book. Was sitting in his mansion somewhere.
Yes, he was waiting to play.
We track him down, or he's a member of the faculty. Any reason why he'd be there more than 5 years, right? So it might be somebody from the class of 1938 is still in town. And I can get all of it. Wouldn't occur to us to do that. In any case, it occurred to Dan to check us. And then with that information and the fact that we were university students for the most part, he could track us down, get our names out of the phone book and so on. And he called each of us. and said, "Hi, I'm looking for somebody to play war games with." And wow, this is great. So he and two other people that I never met before arrived at our next meeting of our war games group in Minneapolis, and there we almost doubled our numbers in one fell swoop. And that book, Strategos, the American Game of War, greatly influenced all of our gaming in the years to come, and it's still echoing down through the community today.
And recently preserved by someone we know too. Yes, so yes. Now tell me, it seems that there were a couple particular nuggets in there that bring us to where we are in the gaming scene today.
Okay.
And you've talked to me before about rather than, although some war gamers I think tend to love this, the hours and hours of rule arguing without a way to arbitrate it, but it would seem that inside this book, you guys discovered something to help take care of that, right?
Well, yes. Those of us who started wargaming in the 50s and mid 60s, you had a very limited set of wargames rules to work with. There were three books that we could find that were on sale in that period, and which were showing up finally in library shelves, which is why we were even looking in the library in the first place. You know, too cheap to buy your own book, right? And they gave some rules, and we all would start, we'd get those books, we'd get ourselves some figures. Airfix made some really inexpensive plastic figures made out of flexi plastic, which the paint peeled, chipped right off of the minute you picked them up because it flexed and the paint didn't. But they were really cheap, and you can get started with gaming in periods Airfix made figures for. And so we were trying them out. Those rules lacked a lot. For one thing, most of us were history enthusiasts, and we're reading book after book about military subjects. Again, another great quest, trying to find books on these subjects that gave you micro details about how thick the armor on a Panther tank was and so on. It was different from finding a book that tells you of the glorious campaign that General Patton wages across France, but doesn't ever get down to the foxholes. In any case, these rules often lacked realism. They had all sorts of flaws in them. And we became really fanatical about getting every last possible detail. So we're struggling and rewriting rules every time we turn around. That produced rules that were full of loopholes. We were in our infancy as to how to write worthwhile rule systems. So we'd get together for a big game, and eventually we had, by 1966, we have probably 12 people showing up for a game, and then it gets bigger and bigger. We get together for a game, we play for a while, some dispute would arise about what exactly the rules meant when they said what they did, and what did we say 2 weeks ago about that, and are we doing it that way again tonight? And the battles would never finish. It would be 2 o'clock in the morning. Remember, we're all college students, so we can stay up all night long and never try to get tired, right? And so we're going along, just spent the evening, ended the evening, and all spent with a vast argument, and the game would never end. In retrospect, I realize now that it was partly because there were people who were insisting on certain historical principles or whatever that were really actually arguing in a rational way. And then there was because there were people who realized they could never lose if the game never ended. And it was to their vested interest to just keep arguing. And then there were people who just like to argue. Lawyers. And although we hadn't come up with the term rules lawyer yet, there was a wave of the future.
Mm-hmm.
Now, all this is really dragging us down. We come back to Strategos, the American Game of War. It's 340 pages long. We are so amazed at a huge volume with so many rules in it that we all of us, when we looked at it, said, yeah, it's great, but we could never play this game. It's just too complicated. It had a very important concept in it, which none of the games, the rule sets that we were getting from elsewhere, commercial rule sets, or all that we were making up. And that was a very valuable concept. That was having a referee. You would have one player who was not playing in the game. He's not on either side. He's there to settle all these disputes and get them to a quick conclusion. That was a really powerful possibility. And there were other things in there that come up a little further down the discussion. But what happened was I looked at it, I said, all right, the entire thing is too big and too complicated. At the time we were doing Napoleonic era battles, you know, circa 1800. And we needed a set of rules that we could all agree on. Well, at least we could agree to use. And so I distilled out and tried to convert a set of war games rules written for the weapons and tactics of 1880s, pretty thoroughly on the experience of the American Civil War, and backdate that by 80 years to about 1800, and come up with tables for the firepower and so on of the smooth bore muskets of 1800 instead of the now brand new breech loading rifles of 1880. The important part of it was that it called for there being a referee who would be riding herd on all of these cats. And there were some players, we trotted these out and we tried them out, and there were some players who just would not go along with the idea that you'd have to subordinate your own will and ego to some other guy who's just the referee for the night, and why do I have to listen to him? But most of the players, as soon as we started having a referee who'd cut off the arguments and keep things rolling, the advantage that gave us in the competitive games, it would end. Then there was another aspect of it that was explained in the Strategos rules in a very small way. There, it assumed that you'll have some officer who's senior to all of your players available to enforce discipline on all of them, because you're supposed to all be Army officers or cadets. But to assume that the referee would be a colonel, that anybody could be the referee who understood the rules and would be fair-minded. An important thing a referee was supposed to be able to do was handle things that worked out very poorly in the standard war games rules of the period, like hidden movement, arriving, a surprise force showing up behind your right flank. These sorts of things would not be handled by traditional war games, because in traditional war games you had to write down rules for absolutely everything ahead of time. And so in Avalon Hill's Anzio game, one of the options is that you can do a parachute drop on the city of Rome as a part of your initial invasion, and all the details about how you will do that are all written out, so it's never going to be a surprise. Do it. Everything you could possibly do had to be written down in advance. With the system that outlining, you have what is properly called a free Kriegspiel, as opposed to a rigid Kriegspiel. These are German terms that Totten did not import into his rule set, but which were the period terms for professional war games in Europe.
And Totten's the author of the book we're talking about,
Strategos. Yeah, Charles Adiel Lewis Totten, West Point class of 1870, is the author of these rules. He spent 10 years after he got out of West Point, he was very high in his class in West Point, he spent 10 years afterwards working on this to come up with a set of war games rules that the U.S. Army could use, as opposed to the imported ones imported from foreign countries where nobody really understood how you're supposed to make it work. So he has a big section explaining what the referee does. European rules, all the guys that are playing them played them when they were cadets, and they know how you're supposed to run a game and what a referee is supposed to do, so their rules never explained this well. But Totten basically establishes an important principle, and that is that the referee covers all the gaps in the rules. He covers everything that can ever come up that wasn't previously written down. He has 340 pages of rules on how to all sorts of things. He has tables of miles of railroad in the various states in the United States. He has how many engines and which kinds of cars are on each railroad, what the pay scales for the U.S. Army are, what the uniforms are. A lot of stuff in there that's really extraneous. But the focus of it is that the referee can run all this thing. The referee will vision the scenario for the battle. He will lay out a map. He will decide what forces are entering from where or are already on the field in certain positions, and how well fortified or whatever they are, and what the objectives of all the different forces are. So you no longer have the traditional 1960s war game of we all bring all of our soldiers over to Greg's house and line them all up. We divide into two teams. We line up all of our guys facing each other across the table, and then we go at it with no more objective than this hill is worth 10 points and that town is worth 20. He, on the other hand, could have very complicated scenarios in which your job is to get the ambulances with all the wounded from the previous battle safely off that corner of the board, and your little cavalry detachment is there to prevent them from being captured. The other side may very well have no idea that you have a string of ambulances up the road there somewhere. They think that they're just advancing to look out for your forces, which may be coming from that direction to attack them. So you're frequently cross purposes. In any case, once I started injecting this into the games that I was running, people got more and more enthusiastic about the games because it allowed you to do all sorts of ingenious things. You encounter the river the bridge has been torn down by the enemy as they retreated. You want to cross the river. You potentially can come to referee Wesely here and say, look, there's a barn over there not far from the river. Can I and my men tear it down and use all the timbers to rebuild the bridge?
There's no rule for that, probably.
There's no rule for doing that, right? It's like, that's a good idea. And then I have to have enough knowledge about what would be involved to make sort of a reasonable estimate of how long it's going to take you. Now, if I've already postulated that river is only 2 feet deep, and if you just tried wading across it, you could get across. Or you might be able to swim your cavalry across and have your infantry wade across, but your artillery wouldn't be able to get across because they'd sink out into the muddy bottom of the river. I can have that in my head before I start the scenario. But if you come up with any kind of a question like that, I can look at it and I can say, right, let me think. All right, fine. You put your guys to work on it. And how many of your men are you using for this? And when the player says, I'm going to use them all. Okay, fine. You know, none of them are on guard duty now. They're all busy tearing down the barn. And I'll let you know when you're done. And then the game goes on. And every couple of turns back, somebody comes in and says, so how are we doing? Well, the barn's getting knocked down pretty good now, you know. And then okay, now you have 12 of your guys on this one timber. And you all lift at the same time. You haul it a half a mile over to where the bridge is. And I could go through all the color on this thing for them. And they would find it fascinating that they'd be going on and they would say, well, you know, we'd have won that battle if I'd just been able to get that bridge finished. So we were having some very imaginative gaming going on, all because of the hints that Totten gave about how referees are supposed to be able to invent things, in addition to just adjudicating things and helping with tedious calculations that the rules called for. Tedious calculations for how many casualties do you inflict in 3 minutes with 58 men lying down behind cover on a ridgetop firing at a column of cavalry at a range of 200 yards. He has tables and tables and tables.
It's a wonder the game isn't still in publication like that.
Oh,
right?
Yes, absolutely.
Forget Pokemon Go or whatever they're playing. They would be playing Totten Strategos, right?
Yes. And in some ways, it's easy to see why. While it was hardly recommended by the U.S. Army High Command, who reviewed the thing, a whole series of generals' names familiar from the American Civil War in 1880 rule on this product that's been put before them and say, yes, we got to get this for every camp and station in the Army, and all the ROTC detachments get them. So I suppose a few hundred of the sets were probably made up and sent out to the various places. But it's also easy to see why, with all the emphasis it has on the latest in military technology of 1880, by 1900, that's all very dated. And all of the officers who remember how badly prepared you were at the beginning of the Civil War to command anything bigger than a battalion of soldiers, because we never had more than that all in one place for most of the years before the Civil War. And all of a sudden we have people who've never commanded more than one platoon of cavalry are suddenly being promoted to major general because they've been out of West Point for 25 years now. And it's they have one coming, have the promotion coming, and they don't know how to run the army. And as everybody knows, the American Civil War is just a bloodbath because there's so much incompetence at all levels in the first 2 years of the war. Well, the people who survived that are in the saddle, in the saddle. They're running the army in 1880, and they say, this is it. We can have all of our guys, all of our young soldiers, officers, can train up on maps, little cardboard counters, and we can do all this stuff. And then when we get into a war in 1890 or whenever, and I'm old and dead, or at least too sick to take to the field and run the army the way I did in 1865, they can step up and they can handle these big commands. That's the theory. In practice, once that generation of officers fades from the scene, everybody who says, you know, son, the only important thing for you is how to chase Apaches, because that's what's going to keep you alive. So you never mind that egghead stuff. We're just going to go out in the field and chase Apaches or whatever. And so the Spanish-American War finally comes up, and this thing is back in the closet somewhere and gets ignored. So a copy is left for me to find at the University of Minnesota Library. Now, that that was a long digression. So let's move back to something.
So the
more
endless
focused
tables of all these different scenarios that are great if you were a world or a Civil War survivor in 1880, and you were going, I think, with the direction of, it was just too much. Was this perhaps into how you developed your strategos rules?
Well, my strategos rules were sort of a distillation from it, but they were still heavily influenced by the get out your slide rule. Remember, no pocket calculators back then. So it was get out your slide rule and multiply this times that and look up another number in another table and so on, and finally come down to, okay, that's 23 casualties, and that's 2.3%, which doesn't make the threshold for testing your morale and that sort of things. It was the rules played. If you had basically all the tables pretty much memorized and you really go to the slide rule, several of us in the group could manage to run that fast enough to make it playable. Now, the rules that I'm using nowadays are nowhere near that sophisticated and intricate. I've become years in the Army, and playing war games in the Army eventually convinced me that, you know, you have rules that aren't all that wonderfully realistic, but the important thing that they are training you on is decision making and dealing with sudden changes and having to roll with the punch. And if, in fact, if people had made these meticulous micro detailed rules for Army war games, say, in 1939, we would have made the same assumptions in the war games, paper war games, that they did in the live war games that they conducted in 1940, which came down to, you don't have to have a very big cannon to knock out a tank. You just have to have some little 37 millimeter gun. If you have, based on our assumptions about what the enemy will have, you can knock out him at a range of 1,100 yards, and he can't knock out you until he gets down to 500 yards. So being a clever war gamer, you always arrange to put your guys just inside of 20 inches away on the tabletop, because he can't kill your tank and you can kill his. This kind of micro detailing stuff, when it turns out that you don't know how much armor there's really on the front of a Panzer IV, and you're in for some very unpleasant surprises as the war goes on, because our ideas of what we need for anti-tank guns were quite inadequate when you really got into combat. So you don't want to teach lessons that are too meticulously detailed, because if you're just wrong a little bit on those details, people have learned how to just ride the edge on the rules that you've got, will have learned all the wrong lessons.
And in a real war, you're not necessarily going to know that kind of information. So if the whole point is to simulate, to some extent, at least the mental strategic process of combat, that's sort of gaming the system too.
Well, it is. And if you wanted to do it right, and you see them not doing it right in historical accounts of the 1930s, in the 1930s, when you went up in your fighter plane to practice dogfighting, you and the other guys from your squadron, all flying exactly the same airplanes, would go up and demonstrate what your tactics were if your opponent had a plane just like yours, which was pretty well guaranteed to not be true with any foreign air force. some would be better than yours, some would be worse, and there are many different features of an airplane, and so they might be faster but not turn as well. They might be able to climb faster than you but not dive as well. All sorts of things like that. Had we done our pre-war training with dissimilar types and had people from different squadrons competing against planes that weren't identical to theirs, we would have learned an awful lot more, which, as it was, we got to learn after we were in the war, much to our disadvantage. So the same thing holds for, now that's physical gaming, sort of. Tabletop war games had the same problems. In any case, we had come up with what was a very fun way to do the games, as long as your referee could work really fast with the slide rule, and because of all the variety and strange things that were going on. And that was very successful for us. No, I think I should just drop out of this and go back to your questions.
Well, so as you're talking about, especially the river scenario, you start to see behind the screen almost, here's what would later become the Dungeon Master, non-Wizards of the Coast trademark, Game Master.
Yes.
But it's interesting because you start to see that thing of you can either on the fly, if you want to make the game more interesting, decide, is that a 2-foot deep river? Or maybe it's a little muddier than they thought. It really is a level of power that as the referee, you can do to either keep things fair or keep things interesting or however you kind of want to run it. Or how I've seen you run a lot of times, you'll just let the dice decide. You'll say, okay, 1 through 3, it's this. 4 through 6, it's this.
Well, there's an important thing about the die rolling too, but I'll get to that a little later, I think. One of the things that I put in my Strategos rules when I wrote them up, my Strategos N rules, the Napoleonic derivative from Cott and Strategos, there is about the third page I'm talking about the duties of the referee and how the referee runs things. And I say in there, you have to remember that the players can attempt almost anything, but not always successfully. Keep the door open for them to investly reward them for being ingenious. And so, if they come and they say they want to build the bridge and I say, fine, you're tearing down the barn, and they have second thoughts and they think, wait a minute, maybe I don't need to build the bridge, and they send somebody over there to check to see how deep the water is. Now, I may have given no thought whatsoever to how deep the water was before that moment, but if I look reasonably convincing and I can answer fast, they won't. There's a great phrase called suspension of disbelief. I think Samuel Taylor Coleridge came up with it, or maybe Lord Byron. In any case, that an important part in any novel is that you don't have things happen that the reader goes, oh, that's just crazy.
Takes
you out of the story. So with refereeing, you are in the same position. They come up and they say, well, I'm going to have some of my guys just try to ride their horses across the river. And at that point, you're going to have to make a snap decision. And one way to do that is you just roll the die. Now, you think about it, you know, behind your Dungeon Master screen, you roll the die. Well, in this case, I would just take a die, not say what the numbers mean, and I'd roll it across the table, and then I'd decide in the meantime what the numbers were going to mean. But I would also generally load things. I mean, I think, okay, well, first, the other side had the foresight to tear that bridge up. Then I'm going to say, oh, yes, and they didn't even have to. It was pointless for them to do that because they can walk right across the river. Mind you that at the Battle of Antietam, exactly that situation occurs where the North tries to capture a bridge across Antietam Creek and discovers after an hour or so that all they really had to do was to tell all the troops to charge right across the creek that have only gotten water up to their waists. So these things do happen in the real world. So I could take a die, and if I roll the die and it comes up 12, well, let's see, 6-sided die. It comes up 6. I can say, well, okay, then that's a really deep river. I'm going to roll it a 1, and gosh, look at that, amazing. Really, it's shallow. So I could settle that in my own mind without saying it out loud. And then I'd turn to him and I'd say, all right, your guys try to cross the river, and their horses get out about 2 feet, and then they're swimming. And if he then asked me, well, can they then swim across? I'd say, well, Yeah, horses can swim pretty well. The horses can get across. You and your cavalry can move across, but you'll have to leave your guns behind. I believe your artillery behind. And something like that. So you make reasonable sort of judgment calls. Side goes, wait, wait, we destroyed the bridge. How did cavalry get over there? So, well, horses can swim, you know. And then we go on, right? So there was a great need to think quickly, invent ingenious and useful situations as opposed to the everybody lines up here and here and attacks each other. And being able to sort of tell the story well so you could sell your decisions and people would stay convinced about them. So that was the style of wargaming that we had evolved between me and, again, only a small number of people actually had all the necessary abilities to sell themselves as a referee and keep people satisfied with what they were doing. And that was, I can't name all the names after 40 years, but prominent among the people who took to this like a duck to water was David Arneson. And so I didn't have to, one of the arguments against having a referee was, poor guy was the referee, what does he get to do? He has to sit out every game, he never gets to play. Well, the answer to that one is have several people who can be referees, and therefore you're not the one who does the refereeing every single weekend. So Arneson and I traded off, and there were three others, I'd say, who were demonstrated reasonable competence at refereeing, and everybody else is happy to let them do all the dirty work, and they just like to play all the time. And we began to understand that there were a lot of psychological satisfactions to being the referee, to putting together this clever scenario, the complicated and intricate instructions to people, and to being congratulated afterwards about how cool that was. And I really liked the part about my horses could swim across the river, and then the other side didn't expect that. And, you know, So it was a lot of fun to do that. So that was kind of a game we were into. And we're doing that up through, well, we're doing that a lot when I go off to graduate school in 1967. I graduated from Hamlin University, bachelor's degree, spring of 67, and the fall of 67, I go off to Kansas to graduate school. And we will now move on to your next question.
Take a sip of beer here. One of the things beer. I thought about as we're talking about that Strategos book, and from what I've heard from you and the gang, is before there was a whole game genre, if we were looking on my bookshelf, there's all these source books and different, sometimes they're called now splat books of just here's a bunch of info on a certain topic of the game. Okay. Yeah. Would you say you guys almost treated some of these military books as your inspiration for how you were going to command your troops or lead the game? Like from what I can gather and hear from the stories you guys have told me of, like, it was almost like, not treating it like fiction, but you'd use that for your own fictional or reenactment battles.
Yes. Of course, you know, in 1958, when I got started on gaming, is followed almost immediately in 1961 through 65 by the centennial of the Civil War. And abruptly, you are surrounded by books about the Civil War. And if you're inclined at all to be interested in it, you can read and read and read. And I was a heavy reader, so was Dave Arneson, and so were many of the other guys. So you found a lot of books that would go into some detail about what it was like to be in the war. An awful lot of them were only at high-level things discussing the strategy and Lincoln's quest to find generals that would do the job he needed done, things like that. But there were also low-level books that really gave you a feel for what was going on. Formative books for me were Red Badge of Courage. It's definitely a great book to read, and that gives you a really good soldier's eye view of what the Civil War was like. Jack Coggins' Arms and Equipment of the Civil War, where he shows you pictures of everything in sight, and he goes into a lot of details about the performance of the weapons. In retrospect, I know now that I've seen the military publications of the time that he's drawing his numbers from, and that there is a certain amount of misleading. He's not intentionally misleading you, but there are people who don't recognize that just because a given cannon can fire a shot that lands 4,000 yards away, it doesn't mean that there's any chance at all of you seeing an enemy target 4,000 yards away to shoot at, and if you did see it, of actually hitting it at that range. Just because the shot comes down that far away doesn't mean the next shot will come down that far away. There's a lot of dispersion in these things. But that's technology that, you know, you come to appreciate the balance between what was written down by various people and the notion of historical research. But you read 12 different people on the same subject, and then you have to work between them as to which ones seem to have done the research and seem to really know what they're talking about, which ones are just coming up with nice slogans. Those books, however, were something we were reading all the time. And we weren't just involved in the Napoleonic Wars or the Civil War or World War II naval battles or World War II air combat. I mean, we were all over the map in terms of the things we were reading about and becoming enthusiastic for. So a neat new movie comes out and we all see it and go, boy, we want to do the Battle of Britain. You know, and so you got into all sorts of stuff, and because madly flitting from one subject to another, hammering out a good set of rules for each one of these when the subject may change next month was probably not going to happen. But the year went by, and we'd visit and revisit different subjects, and we'd come up with, well, that really didn't work, and we did it that way, let's try something else. So there was a constant evolution of war games rules going on in our group and between all in all the other groups of gamers that were coming to life across the country in that period.
So here's a segue. You talked about just what you're saying here about this sort of do-it-yourself, coming up with rules, making things on the fly for your group, trying out different things, experimenting. You go off to school. Did you say fall of 67?
Yeah, fall of 67, I'm off to graduate school.
And we're soon going to be getting to this object here, right?
Yeah, I think we are.
Okay,
the Braunstein. I go to graduate school, and I'm really zealous, and I'm really studying hard, and I'm too busy to do any gaming, and I miss my buddies back home, but I'm really immersed in graduate school. That first semester of graduate school was just wonderful. And then things started to change. The biggest, most, you know, thunderstruck change that hit me was that President Johnson decided that anybody who was in graduate school was a month older than I was a dedicated student of science. And all the rest of us were scum-sucking draft dodgers who should be immediately drafted. And so he revoked all of our graduate school, law school, et cetera, deferments. Now, there were some guys who also had deferments because they had a family, for example, and they were left alone. But out of the 15 of us who started in the physics department and graduate at the University of Kansas, the San Tomei did, only one was still there the next year. And that was because he'd already been in the Navy before he came and went to graduate school. I was there because I cut a deal with the Army to enlist, but then have them delay my going on active duty for 2 years, so I had a chance to get a master's degree. But in any case, in that time period, a lot of my motivation to be a really hardworking student just got blown out of the water by this. And I was only going to get a master's degree. I was always going to stay on for the PhD. The Army wasn't going to wait that long. And so I have time on my hands, and the thought of gaming as a relief from the stresses of the situation certainly arose.
So a passing grade felt a little better than, you know, straight A's at this
point.
Well,
at that point, when you're in graduate school, you kind of don't get graded that way. So, but I was taking the class I had to take, and I was struggling through doing them. But at the same time, the siren song of wishing I could get together with my buddies back in the cities and play games was getting stronger. And so that led me to sit down there and plan up meticulous and convoluted battle scenarios that I could put on when I'd be home on Christmas vacation or Thanksgiving or whatever from college. In the fall of 68, I'm back in school, and I'm thinking about a lot of things, and I began to, I was looking around for something else in this. I'd read a number of books that were abstract things about theory of games. There's one called The Complete Strategist, published by the RAND Corporation, which is really neat and funny book. You can enjoy a lot while reading it, even though it's busy teaching you some very sophisticated mathematical techniques used by real operations research people at, say, the Rand Corporation, for evaluating strategies. And it showed the traditional two-sided game in which A has four strategies and B has nine strategies, and there's this matrix where what if one does one strategy and one does the other, what's the consequence and what's that worth to the one side or the other? And you use this to evaluate your best mix of strategies or to pick out the perfect strategy compared to all the other choices you have. But near the end of that book, he got into the subject of far more complicated math that would be involved in doing this if you had a game with more than just two sides. Now, in spite of all the stuff we'd done up to that point, our games had almost always evolved into just two sides in the game. You were all on the north or the south, or you were all on the French side or the Allied side, the British and the Russians and whoever against them. And you were trying to win the battle as a team. I was aware that in history there were occasions when there was perfidious action on the part of one of the members of the game. And I had on one occasion years earlier, after reading about the Battle of Manzikert, where the Byzantine army is defeated because one of their commanders decides to bump off the other one so he can get control. I'd gone up one game where I'd set that up, and it was a great surprise to everybody, but I would only just that as a one-time thing. Now I got to considering the notion that you could have a game in which everybody doesn't have the same general objective. Again, I'd been poking at that some in the Napoleonic game scenarios that I'd done. You know, the column of wounded being escorted off and the reconnaissance force that's not looking for them blundering in, and then some Spanish guerrillas that are suspicious of everybody who's wearing a uniform. And then, you know, I can populate this. And we did a few things like that when I was running it. But I began to think it would be possible to have a game in which you're not even all soldiers. And so I came back in Christmas of 68, came back home with months of thinking about this, and I designed this game that's going to be run in a little town in Germany called Braunstein. It's the western part of Germany. And in those days, Germany is cut up into 200 little tiny countries, a few of which, like Prussia and Bavaria, are fairly significant, important countries, but most of Germany is just this patchwork quilt of little stuff. And the French Revolution has occurred, and the French have armies on the Rhine River that are looking rapaciously towards Germany as a place to expand the cause of the revolution into, oh yes, and get a lot of loot from too. And so we have a town, and it's caught in the middle of all this. And rumors are the French army is coming. The town isn't very well garrisoned. And there's a college across the river from the town. There's a bridge connects the two of them. There was a student riot in town last night, and the local militia were called out and arrested all the students they could find and threw them into jail. The mayor knows that he has been collecting taxes for years to pay for repairing and maintaining the old medieval fortifications around the city. But like his predecessors, he mostly uses those to line his pockets. There's a hundred other things going on. And what I basically did was I thought of eight different players, two students who are bitterly opposed to each other on the subject of the French Revolution, whose fight sparked the riot last night, the head of the militia, who doubles as the head of the police in town, the mayor, the banker, the Baron of Braunstein. There was this group of eight players that I had planned on using it on. So I put out the word I was going to run this game. I didn't warn anybody about how different it was going to be from our usual war games. When they arrived, they saw the Napoleonics all lined up on a side table and this map created on the top of our three sheets of plywood across the top of the two couches that made our game table, with little buildings and a river and an old castle for the university and all sorts of other stuff on it, and they're going, oh, yeah, we're going to have a Napoleonic battle here tonight.
Yeah, and Dave Arneson is one of these guys
and
there.
Arneson is one of the guys, as I mentioned before, was a really great referee, right? And so he's cast as one of the people. And I expected eight people. I had thought out how the eight people would interact and what their objectives would be, and each of them has his own objective he's supposed to keep secret from other people so that they can't thwart him in his attempts to accomplish them. And they're all going to be pulling in different directions. And a very important part of the game is going to be wheeling and dealing and getting other guys to agree to things that you want to have happen in return for you helping them with stuff. That's the general notion of what's going to happen in the game. As it happened, 22 people showed up. As fast as a new body would come through, I would have to, off the top of my head, invent a new role for him. And what exactly is that he does? So, oh, yes, well, your tavern was where the fighting broke out last night. And after the dust settled, you'd lost a lot of broken furniture and people made off with a lot of your beer. And you want to see the mayor about getting this back because it's you, the way you see it, it wasn't the students who did that. It was all those militiamen after they got them beating up the students who did that. And you think you should be compensated. And then the next guy comes in and I say, okay, you are this poor innocent student who was just caught in the middle of this whole thing, and you're in jail along with the A and B, who are the big instigators of this, and you want to get out of jail and you don't want to get thrown out of the university. And then there's the university chancellor, and you want to get your students out of jail, and you don't want to wind up having to pay big fines to the government. In fact, you really like to get some compensation back for all the damage your students suffered, and it's not a fair cop, and those ruthless militia are beating up on your students every chance they get, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm making them as fast as I can. As
14 new roles 14, on the fly.
14 new roles on the fly. And all of my meticulous planning about how there's this big matrix that shows how if he does this and he does this, then you get so many points for so-and-so. That's out the window. And the way I plan to run the game has completely collapsed because I now have 22 people to talk with in every round. I'm supposed to get each one off for a little private conference in another room and then send them back with orders to bring back somebody else to me. And we're going to rotate it that way. Well, with 8 people, maybe they would have been patient enough for that. But I'm off in my separate room with the charts and maps and all the other stuff. And the other guys are all out in the big main room sitting around the table and talking to each other. And then two of them walk in and they say, "Hi, we're going to have a duel. How do we do it?" And I said, wait a minute. You're the Prussian Jaeger colonel and you're student A. And according to my maps, you're across the river from each other. How can you have a duel?" "Oh, he came over here to town a long time ago and he's giving me a really bad time about the way things are going here. And finally, this young whippersnapper just challenged me to a duel. And I'm a colonel of Jaegers and I can't just turn down a duel. We're going to fight a duel." And I said, "Well, okay then. Here, you get 3d6 and you get 2d6. And the one at the 2d6 said, "Wait a minute, I'm the captain of the fencing team. Why do I only get 2? I said, "Because this other guy is a colonel who's been in the army for 20 years and he's fought dozens of duels to the death. And all you've ever done is stick people with blunt swords that go dent their jackets." "Oh, yeah." So they each rolled their dice and it was like 17-4. And we total blowout. And I said, "That's it. He just ran you right through the heart and killed you dead or the doornail." At this point, Dave Arneson has just been pierced through the heart and killed and is out of the game. And it was an amazing moment. And so at that point, I realized things had been going out in the other room and I hadn't been watching. And sure enough, they're running around in corners and wheeling and dealing and conniving with each other without telling me what they're doing. And so by 2 o'clock in the morning, I had everybody in. We're getting kind of tired by then, even though we are 20-ish college students. I had them into the other little room in a bunch, and I said, "Guys, I'm sorry. I've screwed the whole thing up. I have no idea who won the game." I did not say, "Except Arneson, who's definitely lost." But "I have no idea who won the game. I can't begin. My scoring system is completely broken down, and I'm sorry. I just can't figure it out, but we're all getting tired. It's time to quit." And they all said, "Oh, no, we had a great time. We had a great time. We'll do this again." I thought, they're being so kind to me. And then I went back to Kansas, and that's about 400 miles from Minneapolis, St. Paul, where we were doing the gaming. The next time I came home, which would have been, spring break, I came back and they said, "When are you going to do another Braunstein?" And I was amazed. That's like, "You really meant it? You wanted this?" "Yeah, we had a great time." Okay, so the next time, I put together a new revised version of Braunstein, and I said, I'm not going to let them get out of hand this time. I'm going to keep them, put them in straitjackets. I'm going to hang on to them. So I had it. I did it with only four people. I didn't put the word out I was going to do it. I just got four people together so I wouldn't have too many people to run. And it was worthless. It was boring, and it was a disaster. Oh, my. So I tinkered with it, and the next weekend I tried it again. That would be Braunstein 3. And it was still a disaster. Absolutely no fun for anybody. So I was just glad nobody else had seen that beyond the people I just tried it on. I went back to college. And all the time I'm down in Kansas then, from then until spring, June, when I get to come back to Minnesota, I'm saying, why did it work the first time and not work the second time? And at that point, then I have a flash of insight. There's an old British motto, and they mean something different by it, but it's not whether you win or lose. It's how you play the game. And they mean something about sportsmanship. But what I realized was that the people did not care who won. Some of them were motivated, thinking they were on their way to victory. But really, it was all the weird stuff they did and all the ways they interacted that they enjoyed. And not being able to tell them who won didn't bother them at all. And so I came back and I set up a new scenario, and this one was in Latin America because I just read a book called Coup d'Etat, A Practical Handbook by Edward Lutfak, which is a wonderfully entertaining book, by the way. And I thought, well, Latin American Banana Republic, you have revolts down there and coup d'etats and civil wars and all that. Oh, great possibilities. So I engineered a new scenario where I wouldn't have to have such a tight rein on the players. I'd be able to just let them do their stuff and just run around kind of from group to group. Everybody's talking in a corner. Something's going on here. I run over and say, what are you guys up to? And so it was fun, and we could do it. And I came out, the scoring system did not demand that I hear absolutely everything that ever went on between anybody. And that one was a huge success. And then over the course of the summer of 69, Arneson and I, well, first I, and then Arneson, who had been after me to do it again, he would start refereeing a thing so I get to play sometime. And we did that all the way through. And in the fall, I went back to college. And I came back on the usual vacations. And we played Braunstein games then in fall of 69, winter 69, 70, and on up into the summer of 1970. And in October of 70, having gone to ROTC summer camp for a few months, it's time for me to leave. It's time to go off to the Army. And Arneson said to me, is it okay if I keep running these games and you're not here? And I said, Dave, it's set up in your father's basement. Of course you can run it. And in the back of my brain is a little voice saying, you're going to go to Vietnam and you're going to die. So what do I care? You know. In any case, I went off to the Army, and 3 years later, I gave my life to my country, and 3 years later, they gave it back to me, only a little bit banged up around the edges. And I came back to the gaming community, and I find that I'm simplifying this a lot, but I find that people are playing this Blackmore thing that Arneson has created, which is, as he says in his corner of the Tabletop magazine, a fantasy Braunstein set in the Blackmoors. So that's where I stand and why I'm the ancestor of all this stuff. I could tell you a lot of other little anecdotes, but I'll let the questioner get on with things.
Well, so Blackmore ends up being a game that Dave Arneson shares with Gary Gygax in Lake Geneva, and Dave McGarry shares his Dungeon game, which was a game that's still in print today. And from what I understand, the purpose was, well, now Arneson can play with us. He doesn't always have to referee because it's a board game. But you talked about in Braunstein, Dave Arneson being in a duel and meeting his demise. You told me once that actually in real life, you nearly killed him once.
Oh yeah, that's right.
And I don't know if that's ever been recorded anywhere. So as long as we have a recording right now, okay, we should get this on camera.
We were on the Hamlin University intramural fencing club. And there hadn't been fencing at the school for a long time, but they still had old fencing jackets and masks and foils tucked away in the dust and cobwebs in the back of the phys ed department. And so we got permission to do it, and we got them out, and we're fencing with them. Now, these were not in really great shape anymore. We also were just beginners with very little education, very little training. One of the things that happens when you're fencing is that you're supposed to get the right of way. That is, we clash our swords together, and then at an appropriate moment, one of you makes a lunge and tries to stick the other one with his, mind you, harmless sword, because it's got a button on the end, so it can't go through the canvas of his jacket. You'll get some nice bruises out of it, though. In any case, so you lunge. Well, this is okay as long as you both don't lunge simultaneously. Because when one of you lunges, the other one has, you know, a brief split second to do the appropriate blocking move to keep your sword tip from hitting him. Or jump backwards or whatever. But if you both lunge forward instantly, right in, you suddenly shorten the range between you from the length of a sword plus about 6 inches down to being zero. And that causes the tip of your sword, which normally hits and then bends to cushion the blow somewhat, it causes your sword to like bend almost in half. And when we did that, my old sword snapped off about halfway, a little more than halfway down the length of the blade. And I'm now holding a steel with a jaggedy sharp tip on it. And that goes right in Arneson's jacket from the left and across his, into his jacket from the left and out the other side. Right through the body from side to side at kidney level. And Arneson makes some noises when this happens. And we all freeze in place. And I'm holding the sword, and the bell on the guard is right up against his ribs. and the other, the point is sticking out on the other side. And there's this ominous red blood stain spreading across the back of his jacket. And we are appropriately appalled. So, not knowing it's the wrong thing to do, I pull the sword out, more noise from Mr. Arneson, and we quickly take his fencing jacket off. And we find that, miraculously, I've gone in through the side of his fencing jacket, and instead of running him right through the kidneys, which should probably have killed him in like, you know, 30 seconds, the sword tip has plowed a furrow across the skin of his small of his back, and gone out the other side of his jacket, producing a lot of nice blood, but no fatality. So there was my chance to change history by killing Dave Arneson long before Blackmore Dungeons
and all these books would disappear off the shelf, yes, in an alternate, yes, history. Absolutely. And there's his picture kind of laughing about this story, yeah, on the wall there. So
it's an amazing thing. I mean, you know, it's a, it taught us that we had to make sure we had new swords. That was one thing. it was a stunning moment.
Now we've got some people in the chat right now. So in case, I think there's like a 1 minute delay. So I'm going to say, go ahead and if people want to add any questions. While we are seeing if there's any questions, I would like to do a plug for something that you will be featured in soon. Secrets of Blackmore, okay, is a documentary they've been at your house a number of times.
Yeah.
shooting footage. That is in the post-production stage. And at some point... that should be, I think, in 2017, should be released, I would assume, some theatrical and probably some online releases. And you are one of the key subjects of that. It's been fun to get to know a lot of the guys that are featured telling their story, specifically the Minnesota side of the birth of the game that would become Dungeons and Dragons.
Well, there's a nice trailer for it that's out on the internet that you can find now and just look up Secrets of Blackmoor, as well as a nice testimonial that's just gone out in the last couple of weeks to one of the unsung pioneers of all this, Dwayne Jenkins.
Braunstein, right? Yes.
After I went off to the Army, Arneson's running Braunstein games. And I should perhaps mention the Braunsteins. No, we'll get to that in a minute. He's running the Braunstein games. And in the spring of 71, I've been, you know, home on leave at Christmas once during that time. And then in the spring of 71, I'm still off in the Army again. And Arneson and Jenkins have been doing all these games together. Jenkins is one of the brighter guys. And he was always a great fun guy. He was into joking a lot and so on. But that's more about that in the Secrets of Blackmoor. In any case, he came up with a variant which was set in the Old West. And this was particularly clever because when I did my things, I was forever looking for some big, important historical moment, but in an out-of-the-way place. And so when I did the first one, I did it in Braunstein in Germany in 1796 because we were all in a big Napoleonic campaign. And everybody who was in the campaign who were being used for players in this would know what I meant when I said Landwehr or Hussar, and what the effective range of the weapons was and how people would be armed and dressed and all that, because we're pretty much immersed in that historical period. I found when I came to do restagings of this game at conventions with people who weren't all busy Napoleonic gaming at the time, that I had to spend quite a bit of time explaining things to people, like what the money system is and what the Landwehr is and what the feudal obligations of the Baron of Blackmoor are and all sorts of detailed things that were not immediately known to all the players. Well, and likewise, if I'm doing one in a Latin American banana republic, I have to give you the details about how the army is organized and so on. Whereas with the Old West, we all know what a Winchester is. We all know that a Colt there's six shots, that you mount your horse from the left-hand side, that the bank will have tellers and cages and bank vaults. And, you know, there's a whole series of standard plot items you've seen a million times in every Western. And so he picked a really great era where you don't have to brief the players very much beyond telling them, you know, showing them a layout of the town and telling them that's the bank over there. It was a vast improvement in terms of connecting into something that a large number of people would be already familiar with. But he also made a very important step as well in that, whereas I would run a Braunstein game and its results were that evening, and the next time I ran that scenario, you'd all be starting over again at dawn on the morning of the same day. The players would just be cast. The characters would be played by different people. And each guy would get a chance. Last time around, he was a saloon owner, and this time around, or not saloon owner. Last time around, you were a tavern owner, and this time you're the banker. And so there's lots of different things that you can do with that, but it's the same day over and over. He came up with the very good idea of having what you did last week carry over into when you play it again the next time. So if El Poncho rode into town and blew up the bank while trying to open up the safe, gee, the bank, the gutted remains of the bank building are sitting here and you can't rob it again. And, you know, El Poncho was just some stray Mexican with a few buddies who rode into town last time, but now there's wanted posters for him plastered all over town. And that was good. The other thing that he did, which you will all find very familiar, is the notion that when Dave Arneson played El Poncho in the first game, he kept on playing El Poncho. And his character, therefore, carried on and on and on the way you're used to seeing your player characters do in Dungeons & Dragons. Big, big watershed.
From session to session, the table doesn't reset.
That's right.
You're writing the story
Yes, you are creating a story. Now, role-playing game. There's an interesting term. I didn't call Braunstein a role-playing game because there were already two other things out there in the universe called role-playing games, and it wasn't either of those. Role-playing game was a group therapy methodology used in psychiatry and psychology, in which you would have everybody sitting on their tables. If you've ever seen One Floor of the Cuckoo's Nest, you'll recognize this. You're all sitting around in a circle on your chairs. And the psychologist says, "Now, Donald, we're all going to be animals this evening. What kind of an animal would you like to be?" And Donald says, "I'll be a bear, big, strong, powerful bear." Okay. Now, Dorothy, what would you like to be? Well, I want to be a kitten, a nice little sweet kitten. Okay. Then he comes back and he says, "Now, Donald, what does your bear think about the kitten?" The reason why this seemingly silly thing works is because people have a hard time opening up about their own views as themselves, but they can project into this character and they can have it say things that they won't say, and it can have it reveal things that they won't reveal. It's the classic line of the doctor, "I've got this friend who has," you know, and so that's an interesting use of it. But that was one of the things meant by role-playing games in those days, and that wasn't what I planned on doing. And secondly, role-playing game is an actor's training game, an improvisational theater exercise. The classic, which you've seen if you've ever seen Monty Python very much, is the cheese shop game. Two actors. One is the cheese shop owner. The other one is the customer. Customer comes into the cheese shop and asks for some kind of cheese. And the owner tells him that they don't have it. And then the customer asks for another kind of cheese. And the owner, once again, tells him he can't get that kind of cheese here. The rules to the game are that they can't repeat themselves. So the customer has to know lots of different kinds of cheese so he never repeats himself. The owner of the cheese shop has to know how to say no in a great many different ways without ever repeating himself. And if you've seen, they just literally took this right out of actors' training school and put it out as a skit on Monty Python, and you will watch them as they go on back and forth and back and forth across the counter between, I think it's Michael Palin and John Cleese, as one by one, they finally work their way through until finally the cheese shop owner makes a mistake, realizes as soon as these words have left his lips that he's just repeated himself, and his opponent looks gleeful and you know, hits him up with like five different, "And don't suppose you have any," and tells him several other kinds of cheeses. Now, you can do this again if you want to fill up more airtime on another episode of Monty Python, only this time it's a pet shop owner and John Cleese coming in with his stuffed dead parrot. And again, they go through the interplay, and again, Michael Palin muffs it and repeats himself. And then we get the famous speech, I can't recite it all, but in which John Cleese gives you, I'd say, a minute and a half and a dozen different ways of saying that the parrot is dead, including he has joined the heavenly choirs, he sings now with the angels, he has gone west, he stares with unwinking eyes into the eternity of space, he is, in short, a dead parrot, as he hammers the parrot down on the countertop. And this is just him triumphing in the fact that he had all those other things stored up yet to use that before Palin, which he would have been able to use if Palin hadn't failed. It's great fun to watch it when you know that's what's going on, because now you're not really watching the characters on the skit. You're watching the two actors interacting with each other and one-upping each other. It's a fun thing. But again, that's the other meaning of role-playing game. I, with a real talent for coming up with a catchy phrase, called my little exercises as multiplayer multiple objective games, MP mogs, I guess. That wouldn't was just a sort of an abstract handle for me. I didn't know what to call them, so they wanted being referred to as Braunsteins. By the way, when we went to Latin America, the town you're in is called Piedras Morenas, which means brownstones in Spanish.
And Braunstein being German for brownstone, which was Dwayne Jenkins.
And Dwayne Jenkins did it in America, so it was brownstone, and that was pretty good. And then there's this pattern that emerges beyond that of color something, black moor, gray hawk, and so on. Now about these steins, we shall touch upon these. I had a problem with the people who were interviewing me repeatedly being unable to pronounce Braunstein. It was Braunstein and so on. To which my response was, yes, that's Frankenstein. I finally came up with the perfect way to remind them. I got them some Braunsteins. And the funny thing was that when I ordered these off of eBay, I just generally knew what they looked like. When they arrived, it turned out that they were Grain Belt beer premiums that were advertising promotional items back in the 60s. I looked them up and discovered that, yes, indeed, my father, who was a great fan of Grain Belt beer and had all sorts of Grain Belt beer promotional signs, animated steamboats steaming up the river with Grain Belt beer on the side, written on the side, and that sort of stuff, decorating his bar in his basement where we played the first Braunstein game, and that the little steins I had just bought to hand out to people 40 years later would have been sitting on that bar while we were playing the game. It was just a wonderful full circle sort of thing. So here's what we have. Lift the stein for Braunstein.
Go BS go, is that what you said?
Go BS go. No, if you get a Bachelor of Science in Braunstein University, that's a BS from BS, yep. Which is otherwise referred to as a BS squared from the math department.
We do have a couple comments and questions in here. Hello to Tim at Samwise7, first round fireball, and Happy63Funny asks, was the turn to fantasy, talking about Blackmore, in response to Vietnam?
I don't think so. I have, I've heard some strange proposals that because, of course, Vietnam was sort of hanging over all our heads in that era, that we did various things. I tend to dismiss that. The reason that fantasy came into it was because when we were college students, Dave Arneson and I, and everyone else our age, were college students in the 1964-65 period approximately. When I started college, the big book everybody had to read was Catcher in the Rye by J.D. Salinger. That was soon displaced by The Lord of the Rings by J.R.R. Tolkien. And I had quite a social advantage over everyone because I had actually encountered the book before it hit campus and had gone out and bought the 3-volume hardbound set from Britain with all the big maps folded up in the back. So I had snob appeal over those kids who just had some tacky paperback. And I'd already read it all, and they'd only read like the first volume. And so I was Mr. Cool. But Arneson and I, and virtually all, well, not all the other students, many of them were, of course, much more interested in beer and football than reading. But almost the majority of college students of our age had all read The Lord of the Rings. We thought it was really cool. And there were repeated attempts by various people to bring out Lord of the Rings movies, long before the famous one we all have seen now, which is such a nice job. And they all floundered. But you can look them up on YouTube nowadays. It's easy to find them. In any case, we all thought The Lord of the Rings was really cool. And we dug around, and most of us found other books by J.R.R. Tolkien, The Silmarillion, and so on. So we are pretty well steeped in that era. And I don't see it was anything about Vietnam, because we got interested and hooked on it before the before there was an American, well, I can't see it. We had a time when, as far as the general public is concerned, Vietnam, they couldn't even find it on a map. And the fact that there were some American advisors out there in 1962 didn't ring much of a bell with us, right? So it wasn't until about the time that I went off to graduate school in 67 that things started heating up about Vietnam. But again, we weren't doing this stuff in response to Vietnam.
Some comments in here about how it feels like role-playing in role-playing games feels like group therapy in a lot of ways, which is interesting because it does allow you to, with little risk other than your ego, as you said, and I think the Strategos rules I got on my shelf somewhere, but the thing that really opened up with a role-playing game is you can attempt anything. Mm-hmm. And as I've unsuccessfully tried to win people over and explain some of these games for, well, how do you win? And I say, well, you win if everybody's having fun.
Yeah.
That sounds dumb.
But that was, you know, 9 out of 10 of us don't care if there's some kind of a point system that you can say, I scored 113 points and therefore I win. So there. There are some people who are totally driven by the have to outdo everybody thing. That's a personality item. And there's opportunities for them to do that in traditional role-playing games. But, and of course, there's, once you get into a situation where you have experience points, you get a reward in terms of it improves the capabilities of your character if you're successful. But most people, when you ask them about really fun times I've had in role-playing games, they'll tell you a story something like this. They'll say, well, where was this tall tower? And there were no doors or anything except like 200 feet up, there was this window. So our magic user used his levitate spell to pick up my thief and just float me right up there to the window so I could pick the lock on the iron bars and open it up. And then a black dragon came out of the window, incinerated me, and then came down and wiped out the entire party. But we were doing so good up to that point with that really clever thing about levitating me up there so I could pick the lock. And they stole the whole thing. Oh, yeah, and then when the dragon came after me, I had my plus 12 Hackmaster sword, and I knocked one leg off, but he still got me. And they go through the whole routine, and they are really happy about it, even though it was a TPK. A total party kill. It's just, we didn't care that we lost. What was cool was all the neat stuff we did before we lost. And that's the case for the great majority of gamers. But I recognized after doing gaming for a long time, there's a whole social dimension to gaming that's going on across the table between the players at the same time that there is game activity going on the table. And this is true for bridge players, too, by the way, except for the absolutely most steely-eyed and dedicated who utterly refuse to talk to anybody while they're playing the game. They're just, that's it. And likewise, there are people who play poker with a lot of schmoozing and passing bottles and potato chips around. And there are people who play poker with that steely-eyed, just there to win and take the money attitude. But all kinds of games, for the most part, are means of social interaction between the players. Was there more to the question I didn't cover? I feel like I just fired a shotgun at that question. Sorry.
Well, it was more of a in response to a comment of how role-playing games can feel like a group therapy. But
oh, I'm sorry. Yes, I should back up to that slightly. Yes, although I was trying to stay away from the group therapy stuff because I figured, well, you know, if we get tied into the role-playing game group therapy stuff, it's going to be completely off the mark. Because early on, when this stuff first started breaking, people were hearing about Dungeons and Dragons, there was a question that arose in the hobby, which is, what is the generic name for this? TSR, that's T copyright, R, S copyright, R copyright, had copyrighted everything in sight and told everybody that if you dared to use the word Dungeons and Dragons or D&D or DND, that their lawyers would be all over you. And the problem then was, how do you describe those other similar to the game we cannot mention? Was it the game of Voldemort, perhaps?
Don't speak of it
because of the lawyers. There's this other game published by this group called Flying Buffalo that we really kind of like more, perhaps, or don't like as much, or it's a transparent ripoff of the game we cannot mention, or whatever position you were going to take as a reviewer. How did you refer to this thing? And coined for this was adventure gaming. And I wish that had been successful, because it seemed like a nice term. Unfortunately, somebody else then ran right out and started a magazine called Adventure Trademark Gaming Trademark, and just put us right back in the box again. So some genius came up with role-playing game, who I don't think had the foggiest notion that had ever been used before, but it was certainly going to be hard for anybody to trademark that because it had been around for about 50 years already.
Scenes et fair.
Yes.
It's out there.
Yes. So that's where the term came in. Almost immediately after that was being used, someone did research. Amazing. A reporter who does research on the subject of role-playing games and hit the gold mine of everything ever written about the psychological role-playing games. And therefore immediately announced that he'd found out that Dungeons & Dragons was really inspired by the work of pick a dozen different psychologists in the preceding half century who must have been where they got it all from. Completely off the mark. So anyhow, we're stuck with it. It's the term that's caught on. All I can say in its defense is almost anybody who hears role-playing game used now doesn't even begin to think about training actors or psychoanalyzing the patients.
And the danger with calling it an RPG is you get flagged by the FBI. I mean, just saying this on a live thing, the CIA probably already knows now that we're talking about RPGs. But we mean role-playing games, not the rocket-propelled grenade.
That's true.
Well, we've got about 15 minutes left. Had a question about solo games where the player is the ref. I guess that's kind of like keeping yourself honest.
Well, yeah, I mean, in a solo game, of course, you're running the game and you're deciding what's going on. And many solo games have complicated schemes, self-guided adventure things. If you pick the left-hand corner, go to paragraph 295. If you pick the right-hand corner, go to paragraph 306. Choose your own adventure, exactly. And in fact, another term that came out back then in the we don't know what we're calling ourselves was interactive fiction, which was also a really neat idea. Somebody hit on the fact that, in effect, this is storytelling, but with the added dimension that I start telling you this story when I, as the referee or dungeon master, if you will, start out the story. But your contributions from everybody else in the group makes the story modify and change and grow and carries on. And so it's a group effort towards telling a story. And that seemed a really good idea to me until somebody founded a magazine called
Interactive Fiction
Trademark. You'll have to excuse me for a minute.
Oh, no problem.
Okay.
So we're going to
tell the people some neat stuff.
We're going to give Dave a minute here. This is a great chance.
You got it? Rather close to the floor, yes. I'll
be right back. We're going to give Dave a chance. And I think I have the perfect question when he's back to end the discussion with here. But if you do have any questions you want me to ask, go ahead and throw those in the comments here. Some great stories that he's told me over the time that we've gotten to know each other. Now, Dave often runs a game that I have the privilege of going to and gaming with. I'm trying to think. This poster here up is something that he used to have something very similar in his basement in Minneapolis here. In one of the weekend papers, there was an article about Twin Cities Wargamers. I actually contacted the Minnesota Historical Society about to get a copy of this. Now, Dave had it in his game room, which is fantastic. It's like above the garage, big area for gaming in. He's got a framed picture of the article. So I get the microfilm version of this article from the Minnesota Historical Society, and it's just the pictures are completely blacked out. You can read the text okay. So it was better to just grab a snapshot of Dave's stuff. But in that article from, it was either the Minneapolis Star or the Tribune, and then they merged to be the Star Tribune, but anyhow, in this, there's a picture of Dave in his father's basement, the one with the beer mugs that he mentioned earlier, leaning over a table that's all set up. I believe the headline was Tabletop Generals Fight in Miniature or something to that effect. And behind him is a poster like that of all these different soldiers and their different uniforms and stuff. So in my own game room, in many ways, in homage to the history of Minnesota gaming here, I've got a poster just like that in here. So it's been fun to get to know some of the guys. One of the guys pictured in that photo is Dave Arneson. One of the funny things that Dave Wesely has told me before is that, you know, had I known, he'd be the one with the co-creator of such a huge game, I would have had him pose better, because you can just sort of barely see Arneson's face as he's reaching for something on the table. So it's been a lot of fun. Some of the different artifacts, if you look over here, I'll show it to you here. This castle is not the exact castle, but it's the same model kit. If you were to walk into Dave Arneson's basement in Minneapolis, one day he said, hey, we're going to explore the dungeons beneath Castle Blackmoor. And actually, one of Dave's good friends, Bill Hoyt, gave me this. This used to belong to Dave Arneson. So this is one of my prized items in my collection, is one of Dave Arneson's Blackmoor Castle model kits. So it's fun to have a lot of these things to have and share and be a part of. So Mr. Wesely is making his way back. The door doesn't shut. The house is still settling. So that's on our fix-it list.
Well, I kept rolling this, but I couldn't seem to come up and shut the door.
Yeah, shut door, exactly.
It's a skill. That's the opposite of the theme skill set, right?
So I think a good question to wrap it up for our last question. Okay. Now, you're a Minnesotan, which means we don't like to make a big deal out of ourselves. That's a Minnesotan thing, right?
That's right.
But I would like to ask you this question. If you look at this bookshelf, if you look at all the games on the bookshelf here, even into how all this has turned into even larger franchises like World of Warcraft, you know, people argue that in video games, the whole idea of leveling up, all this sprang out of wanting a escape from graduate school and coming up with this role-playing game. When you look at all this that has been birthed out of not only the resurrecting that concept of the referee, but the role-playing game, are there some things you do look at and you're proud of what it's done for people or communities? And again, it's very un-Minnesotan to do anything that would seem like bragging, but
I am happy that there's thousands and millions of people out there playing these games I did. There are times that I would argue that some ideas come along when the circumstances, when the conditions are right for them. And so if the Wright brothers' first flight had been a fatal crash, which was certainly what they're risking, and the surviving brother had said, oh, the hell with that, and gone back to doing bicycles and stayed away from it, right? We might all remember the Wright Motor Car Company instead. But there's every reason to believe that within a few more years, the hundreds of other people who are trying to replicate, build working airplanes based on the work of Gustav Chanute and Sir George Cayley, we're finally got the, and their airplanes have been more than just toys that can barely get off the ground. And they would have ultimately provided us with airplanes a decade later, perhaps, or even 20 years later if there were just too many fatal crashes and people got turned off again. But eventually the technology would have made it possible to do it. So by now, 50 years afterwards, would somebody have come up with these things? I suspect it would have been invented, you know, on its own. I'm happy that it descends from what I did on the schedule that I was on. But there were many steps along the way. And I have to say that if it hadn't been for Gary Gygax, who was willing to bet everything he owned on putting Dungeons & Dragons into production, at a time when he had perfect evidence in front of him, the company that he'd been doing business with as an author, Guidon Games, had just gone belly up. He had every reason to believe that it was a doomed exercise to start your own game company, but he went ahead and he put it all on the line to get that thing into publication and get it out there. And then he worked furiously to make it sell and to make it over the hump and to keep from going out of business. And that was essential. If it hadn't been for Gary doing that, there might be a couple of hundred people playing Blackmoore who had met Dave Arneson at some regular war games convention or who had met him in the Twin Cities and had been shown how to do it by them and their friends and were still sort of going along on the publish-it-yourself thing. If it hadn't been for Dave Arneson, I don't think anybody would be remembering Braunstein. Arneson, when his dedication to getting the thing going and to tying it into the Lord of the Rings realm was really critical to making this all happen. I would have gone off. I'd have come back from the army. Arneson would be in his job as a teacher someplace and not doing it anymore because he'd had to take a job in South Dakota maybe, and the group would have been still playing war games. And I'd have said, hi, it's nice to see you guys. And I would have gone back to graduate school and then gone back in the army, which I did do. And I wasn't going to have spent the next 30 years of my life pushing Braunstein on people. So there's you know, essential steps. And Dwayne Jenkins, Braunstein, same thing. Those are all things. The ball was carried forward by many people. Right? I threw the pass and somebody caught it. Okay. So I would like to say in one bit of parting stuff here that if you want to hear all about this in enormous more detail with a lot more witnesses, thus far you've heard me bragging about all this, but for all you know, I'm lying. Okay. But there's lots of people out there that are in the Secrets of Blackmoor film that's being brought up. And these guys have documented and found evidence and just piles and piles of things that fill out the story in much more detail. And you'll hear other people than me telling you about how it all happened. So you really should get your hands on it when you can. Anything else? Any other questions?
Well, we've got a real princess with us here, I guess, to close out the
nice.
Show. Oh, and we have a princess on a unicorn. Come here, say hi to the camera. Neat. They've been patiently waiting for 2 hours for their on-screen debut, and here they are.
How is your unicorn? Here, let me show it.
Well, thank you, everybody, for tuning in, and this will, in posterity, stay online for people to see through the coming weeks and even years. But Dave, I would like to personally thank you for coming down for and just
I'm
for
having a spell cast
you're mesmerized by this for coming down answering these questions. There are so many great stories and things that we could keep chatting about. But I would like to say just what fun it's been to get to know you and the gang. It's made me a better man, made me a better man and husband and dad for them with the friendships that I've forged with you guys. And, you know, as you say that with how the game had integral players in the same way as the genre, that type of game almost came about like a story that needs to write itself, interactive fiction. Right. This is interactive nonfiction of people's choices making a brand new outcome that couldn't have been predicted. So
and to talk about the Wright brothers analogy, there's 100 mm-hmm. other people in Europe who are trying to build airplanes at the time, and some of them are pretty close. At the time that I was doing my stuff, and immediately thereafter, there's Empire of the Petal Throne.
Yep.
The phenomenally detailed world that had been created by Dr. Barker.
Here in the Twin Cities, too.
In the Twin Cities, as a place in which to set his fantasy stories. He was trying to replicate the Lord of the Rings, a grand, sweeping, enormously detailed world. One of his students, from time to time, he's too shy to get these things published. But from time to time, when he had students that he liked particularly, he would read them chapters out of his latest novels and introduce them to the world of Tecumseh. And one of his students said, that could be a really great Blackmoor adventure. And so there is this dim chance that the two, Arneson and Barker, could have gotten connected together, that the effort going into the Tolkien cloned world of Blackmoor could have gone into getting Empire of the Petal Throne rolling, because someone actually did crank out a set of rules for it with a mimeograph machine. And it's possible that since, well, Arneson had no money to publish these things himself, it's possible that Dr. Barker, being a guy with a house and a career and everything, could have raised the money to put Empire of the Petal Throne out on the marketplace. And maybe EPT would be what we all remembered as being E-copyright, T-copyright.
Yeah.
But Empire of the Petal Throne might have been the game that came out and caught the imagination and took off and went places. In a world in which there is no Dungeons and Dragons and no tunnels and trolls and no rune quest and all those other things, he might have been the mainspring that got it going. I don't know. It would be hard, very hard to have done it. Gary's dedication was critical to getting all this to roll the way it did.
Yeah.
And we could remember that EPT is this thing you see copies of in antique stores and so on that were remaindered when the company that was publishing it gave up.
Well, in the spirit of the type of gaming genre you invented, if you wanted to, you could even role play your own game of Twin Cities or late 60s, early 70s students coming up with games and genres.
Oh, yeah. So. Well, of course, the people from Bothered About Dungeons and Dragons have an own entirely different interpretation of all this. Charles Eddie Lewis Totten, I don't think any of them actually have made this connection, but I lay it out there for their beneficiation, right? You know how H.P. Lovecraft stories go. The student or researcher or whatever finds the old musty tome and he opens it up and he starts reading in the spells and all of a sudden
slips into madness. Yeah,
he slips into madness. The demons appear, whatever, right? Well, so here we are. Charles Zadia Lewis Totten, after he wrote the Strategos de American Game of War, as one of his grandsons once said to me, well, old Charlie got very strange in his old age. He eventually got out of the army and got involved. He was very rich, by the way. He got involved in the British Israelite movement and all sorts of other arcane stuff, and wrote books about all the Indians being descended from the lost tribes of the Jews, lost tribes of Israel, rather, about how all the various languages were really from them, too. And on and on. He did a lot of stuff like this, and it's very strange. And he was well tied in with the occult circles in the U.S. in the early 1900s. So here is this author of books about occult stuff, and he leaves this book that's found by the innocent students in the basement of the U of M library. And they dust off the cobweb as they open it and they start reading it. And soon they're chanting things like 10 feet, 20 feet, 30 feet, passage going right, passage going left. And then, of course, they lose their souls.
Well, I see, but I know you too well. You have your soul, and you seem to have stayed with your sanity intact and stood the test of time. But I do like that idea of the alternate history of what it means.
It, so. You know, it just begs somehow. I could see if I had the talent of writing the of all this, that it would be fun to really pull out all the stops on Lovecraftian writing style and do it all right.
Yeah. Well, with my kids here, one last reminder, BrigadeCon, one of the things that makes this convention special is all the proceeds, if you get a t-shirt or if you donate, this is a free convention, but we encourage people to consider donating to Child's Play Charity, where kids who are in a lot worse shape than these two hooligans here are given games and toys and things to help brighten up their stays in hospitals, domestic abuse shelters. And so gaming, role-playing is doing good in the world and helping sick kids in hospitals to have a ray of hope. So that's pretty awesome.
Yes, I'm happy that that's worked out well. A few years ago, there was not just bothered about Dungeons & Dragons, because they were pretty over the top and hard to believe. But there was at least one occasion in New Orleans where some kids were playing as a vampire role-playing game, and they actually killed somebody, thinking it would be way cool to do that. Now, there's always been kids who killed somebody, about 1,000 of them last month in Chicago, for example. So that's not a new thing. But it was disturbing to see that. And I got a copy of the game they were playing, and I said, well, I was once asked, is this going to make kids go crazy, this Dungeons and Dragons stuff? And I said, no, because it's impossible for you to walk down the street after you play Dungeons and Dragons thinking that you're really a 7'6" barbarian superhero with a big sword. On the other hand, the mythos in the vampire game they had was that, the vampires are all among us and they disguise themselves as humans. And so you could walk down the street thinking that you are indeed count whatever the vampire disguised, merely disguised as a human at the moment, but you're really a vampire. That's more seductive for people who aren't too well connected with reality.
Yeah.
And I was a bit nervous about how far that could go. But that's, the fringe. I mean, there's all sorts of stuff we've gone into. Now you're in the same position as somebody makes perfectly good gun for hunting and somebody else can take it and go and kill people with it.
Well, and that's the thing too, I would think, is the Stackpole report is one that's been out there where I remember him saying once in an interview, I wish I could find one conclusive, like, no, this was solely responsible because of the game. But I think what it is you have fringe people and that just happens to be the means by which they carry out whatever those things they were vulnerable towards. If it wasn't that, it could have been something else very easily.
Well, so. Yes. I mean, if one of the things that caused the enormous explosion of Dungeons and Dragons into the marketplace was James Dallas Egbert III, 16-year-old genius who went off to college and Michigan State University at Ann Arbor, unsupervised. The college was in college is probably responsible for much of which happened, because they should have been considering he's a minor and they should have been taking more care of him. But it was also a time frame when the whole notion of the college being in loco parentis was being widely disputed. It's, the mid-70s, after the liberating 60s, and the idea that you'd have this kid, but you keep him like locked up in the underage dormitory or something. That's gone out the window by that point. It would be very hard for them to have bucked the trends enough to keep him under control. And he had numerous problems that Dungeons and Dragons were not contributing to. And but when he disappeared, and there's a good book called The Dungeon Master by the detective who was hired to find him, in which he admits that the whole thing, the Dungeons and Dragons connection, was completely a mistake on his part, that he thought he'd hit on something really cool, and he was grandstanding for the press, and he made all these pronouncements and caused enormous consternation when actually the kid took off because he found somebody to give him free drugs. It was a tragedy for him and his family and everybody, but it was just a shot in the arm for Dungeons and Dragons, because immediately everybody who'd never heard of it had to find one to read it. And the sales went through the roof. And, you know, the phrase in Hollywood, there's no such thing as bad publicity. Mm-hmm. And did they spell the name right? And Gary got to appear on The Tonight Show and just everything, right? And Gary was there in the thick of it, just lapping up all the free publicity, and it was great for the company's sales.
Yeah.
And it was, you know, the alternative would have been, I may say it was lapping it up, but honestly, you had to kind of roll with the punch, because what the alternative was to, I guess, to just like hide out in your castle and refuse to interview with anybody, whereupon all the worst conjectures would have been raised, right? So I can't fault Gary for seizing the opportunity to look as good as he could out of what was potentially very adverse publicity. But that's what really got the bothered about Dungeons and Dragons, satanic cult speculation rolling.
Well, as a closing teaser, in early November, I've written a blog post for Tabletop Terrors as a gaming website. And the title is, You Guys Don't Look Like Satanists. And it's all about this last February when I got to play a game of Dungeons and Dragons with a bunch of you on the Blackmore gang. So when it's published, I'll put a link in the notes if people are watching this later. Again, we raise one more stein for Braunstein.
We're keeping our eye on you?
That's right. Your Illuminati eye. That's weird how you guys always tag me and scan our RFID thing you injected me with when I go to game. But, you know.
That's right. Well, no, it's that we wipe your mind after every session so you don't realize how many times you're coming to see us.
That's what it was. Okay, well, hey, so, cheers.
Cheers.
Thank you to Major David Wesely for his time with us today, his contributions to the gaming industry and what it is. And I know for many of you it's meant a whole lot. So thank you. Appreciate it. Okay. Cheers.
Here's to His Majesty Friedrich Wilhelm II.
Okay. Braunstein, near the Schweinhex River, as our friend Pete would always chime in.
Yep.
Take care, guys.
Go on.